Hello viewers, today we are going to study about angiogenesis, invasion and metastasis. Sustained angiogenesis is a cancer hallmark. So why angiogenesis is important for the growth of tumors? Because a solid tumor, even if it possesses all the genetic aberrations required for malignant transformation, it cannot grow beyond 1 to 2 millimeter in diameter unless it has capacity to induce angiogenesis. So the growing tumors stimulate new angiogenesis, in which new vessels sprout from the capillaries, and these new vessels are leaky and dilated. They supply the tumor cells with nutrients and oxygen. The proliferating endothelial cells stimulate the growth of the tumor cells because they secrete insulin-like growth factors and platelet-derived growth factors. The proliferating endothelial cells secrete these factors, which stimulate the growth of the adjacent tumor cells. And also these new vessels, they provide an easy access to the tumor cells. Thus, they contribute to metastasis. Now, the angiogenesis is controlled by a balance between angiogenesis promoters and inhibitors. Early in the stage of development of tumor, most of the tumors do not induce angiogenesis. They remain small, in situ, in a quiescent stage until the angiogenic switch occurs, which removes the state of quiescence of these tumors. So in angiogenic switch, there is local production of angiogenic factors and or loss of angiogenic inhibitors. So these angiogenic factors are produced by the sources: tumor cells, the infiltrating inflammatory cells, for example macrophages, tumor associated stromal cells and extracellular matrix. So these are the sources of angiogenic factors. Now what happens in case of tumors? The relative lack of oxygen due to hypoxia stabilizes the hypoxia inducible factor 1 alpha. Now this activates the transcription of pro-angiogenic cytokines, vascular endothelial growth factors and basic fibroblast growth factor, and thus it leads to angiogenesis. Now driver mutations in tumor suppressor genes and oncogenes, they also favor angiogenesis. Now the function of P53, it stimulates the expression of anti-angiogenic molecule thrombospondin 1, and it represses the expression of pro-angiogenic molecule vascular endothelial growth factor. Now if there is loss of function of P53, what will happen? It will favor angiogenesis. Similarly, gain of function mutations in RAS and MYC upregulate the expression of vascular endothelial growth factor. So loss of function mutation in tumor suppressor gene and gain of function mutation in RAS and MYC. So they will favor angiogenesis. The proteases. Proteases are elaborated by tumor cells and stromal cells. They influence the balance between pro and anti-angiogenic factors. Some proteases release basic fibroblast growth factor, which is pro-angiogenic, from the extracellular matrix, and others release anti-angiogenic factors, angiostatin and endostatin. Angiostatin is released by proteolytic cleavage of plasminogen, and endostatin is released by proteolytic cleavage of collagen. So it is established that angiogenesis is essential for the growth of tumors, and this has led to the development of the angiogenic inhibitors. Bevacizumab, it is a monoclonal antibody and it neutralizes the vascular endothelial growth factor activity, and thus it prolongs the life of patient. Now next is invasion and metastasis. Ability to invade and metastasize is an important cancer hallmark. and local invasion can produce damage to vital structures, and it is required for distant spread to sites that are physically discontinuous with the primary tumor. And this is accomplished through a series of steps which is called as metastatic cascade. So in metastatic cascade, the cancer cells, they break away from the primary site, they enter the vessels or the lymphatics and produce a secondary growth at a distant site. But this process is not as simple as it looks, because the tumor cells, they encounter various challenges and they have to overcome these challenges in the form of host immune defense, and they have to adapt to a new microenvironment at the site of secondary growth. It can be the microenvironment of a bone marrow, of a lymph node, or of a brain, and this microenvironment is quite different from that present at the primary site. Now, with the evolution of the tumor, there is clonal expansion, growth, diversification, angiogenesis, and metastatic subclone arise. And for successful metastasis to occur, there has to be collaboration of multiple subclones, which will provide different skills or which will perform different functions so that the process of metastasis is successful. So for successful metastasis, the cancer cells, they must arise or they must migrate as a cohesive cluster of cells. And in the cluster, there are different subclones that have different that will perform different functions, that will have different skills for making the process of metastasis a success. Now the metastatic subclone arises. So in the metastatic phenotype, it requires accumulation of complementary genetic and epigenetic alterations that promote the metastatic cascade. Now the metastatic cascade occurs in two phases. First is the invasion of the extracellular matrix, and second is vascular dissemination, tissue homing and colonization. The first step, invasion of extracellular matrix. The extracellular matrix comprises the basement membrane and the interstitial connective tissue. So this is the interstitial connective tissue and these are the basement membrane. So the both these basement membrane and interstitial connective tissue, they are made up of collagens, glycoproteins and proteoglycans in various combinations. So for the tumor cells to migrate, or the first step in the metastasis is it has to breach the basement membrane. So the tumor cell breaches the basement membrane, then it traverses through the interstitial connective tissue, and to gain access into the circulation, it has to penetrate the basement membrane of the vessel. And then the same steps are repeated in reverse when the tumor cells, they extravasate and deposit at a secondary site. So the first step, invasion of extracellular matrix, can be resolved into various sub-steps. These are loosening of tumor cell interactions. Second step is the degradation of extracellular matrix. Third is attachment to remodel extracellular matrix components. And fourth is the migration and invasion of tumor cells. So let us study these steps one by one. Now the first step is the invasion of extracellular matrix. In this, the first sub-step is loosening up of tumor cell interactions. So in the first step, there is occurring dissociation of the tumor cells from one another because of alteration in the adhesion molecules. Normally the epithelial cells, they are tightly glued to each other and to the extracellular matrix through a variety of adhesion molecules. Eke adherins, these are transmembrane glycoproteins. So they keep the epithelial cells adhered to each other and they also relay signals between the cells. The loss of eke adherin function can occur in various epithelial cancers due to mutations. For example, in adenocarcinoma, stomach, breast, and also in various other epithelial cancers, the eke adherin expression is silenced through epithelial mesenchymal transition. And this epithelial mesenchymal transition, it is integral to the metastasis of epithelial cancers, particularly the carcinoma of breast, carcinoma of prostate. And EMT is controlled by transcription factors SNAIL and TWIST. And it is marked by not only by the down regulation of epithelial markers, for example E-cadherin, but also by up regulation of mesenchymal markers, for example viamentin and smooth muscle actin. And these changes favor the pro-migratory phenotype, which is essential for metastasis. The second is the degradation of extracellular matrix, degradation of the basement membrane and the interstitial connective tissue. So this is accomplished by tumor cells which secrete proteolytic enzymes, and the tumor cells also induce the fibroblasts, inflammatory cells and other stromal cells to secrete proteolytic enzymes. These enzymes are matrix metalloproteinases, cathepsin D, urokinase, plasminogen activator. So the matrix metalloproteinase, they not only cleave and remodel the extracellular matrix, but they also release some factors which contribute to the malignant behavior of the cancer. Now the matrix metalloproteinase, it performs these functions. The matrix metalloproteinase, which is a gelatinase, it cleaves type 4 collagen in the basement membrane, stimulate the release of vascular endothelial growth factor from extracellular matrix sequestered pools, and it also generates collagen and proteoglycan cleavage products with the chemotactic, angiogenic and growth promoting effects. So the cleavage products, they have chemotactic, angiogenic and growth promoting effects, which further favors the malignant behavior. Now the benign tumors of breast, colon, stomach, they have little matrix metalloproteinase 9 activity, whereas the malignant counterparts, they overexpress matrix metalloproteinase 9. And also in certain tumors, the metalloproteinase inhibitor levels, they are reduced. So all these favor the tissue degradation, which is required for metastasis. Now the third step is the attachment of the tumor cells to the remodeled extracellular matrix. So the third step is attachment of tumor cells to remodeled extracellular matrix proteins. The tumor cells, they demonstrate complex changes in the expression of integrins. Integrins are transmembrane proteins that participate in the adhesion of cells to each other and to the extracellular matrix. Now in normal epithelium, the integrins, they help in adhesion of the cells to the basement membrane collagen and laminin, and they are expressed on the basal aspect of the cell. Thus they help in maintaining the cell in a resting polarized state. Now if there is a loss of adhesion in normal cell, then it undergoes cell death by apoptosis, and such type of cell death is called anoikis. Anoikis, it means without a home. Now if a loose tumor cell or a tumor cell that has dissociated, or there is loss of adhesion in the tumor cell, then it doesn't undergo anoikis because of expression of other types of integrins which promote cell survival. And also the matrix is modified, which promotes invasion and metastasis. There is cleavage of collagen 4 and laminin in the basement membrane by matrix metalloproteinases 2 and 9, and this generates novel sites that bind to the receptors present on the tumor cells and stimulate migration. Next step is the migration and invasion of tumor cell. Locomotion. Locomotion is the final step in invasion, and in this there is a propelling of the tumor cells through the degraded extracellular matrix. And this process involves many families of receptors and several signaling pathways. Now these cells, they attach to the matrix at the leading edge and they detach at the trailing edge. They detach from the matrix at the trailing edge. And there is contraction of the actin cytoskeleton which help in moving the cell forward. Now several factors are involved that stimulate and regulate this process. These are tumor cell derived cytokines including chemokines and growth factors including the insulin like growth factor which act as autocrine motility factor. Cleavage products of matrix components, collagen, laminin, they have chemotactic effect. Stromal cell derived paracrine factors, hepatocyte growth factor which binds to receptor tyrosine kinase MAT on the tumor cell and stimulate the motility of the tumor cells. Now the second phase in the metastatic cascade is vascular dissemination, homing and colonization. The second phase in metastatic cascade is vascular dissemination, homing and colonization. Now, once the tumor cells are within circulation, they are vulnerable to destruction by various forces like mechanical shear stress, apoptosis due to anoikis, innate and adaptive immune mechanisms. So how the tumor cells are able to metastasize? The tumor cells, they are not migrating as single cell. They are migrating as multicellular aggregates. Clumping of the tumor cells promotes cell survival. There are homotypic interactions between the tumor cells and there are heterotypic interactions between the tumor cells and the blood elements, particularly platelets. So these interactions enhance the tumor cell survival. The tumor cells express anionic substances like polyphosphates which activate factor 12 and this leads to fibrin deposition and stabilization of the tumor emboli. And this enhances the chances of the tumor emboli to arrest within the capillary beds. And the tumor cells in group possess the required properties needed for metastasis. A single cell doesn't possess all the properties. So they are in group, so they possess the required properties needed for metastasis. One of the properties, stem cell-like property. So it ensures relentless growth and plasticity that is needed for adaptation to the new microenvironment at the distant site. Now the factors that determine homing and colonization, these are location and vascular drainage of primary tumor, tropism of particular kinds of tumor cells for specific tissues and escape from tumor dormancy. The first, location and vascular drainage of the primary tumor. So this is a matter of simple anatomy. For example, colonic carcinoma give rise to mets in the liver because liver lies downstream the colonic tumor. So the tumor give rise to mets in the liver. But there are exceptions like breast carcinoma, prostate carcinoma, they metastasize to bones. Bronchogenic carcinoma metastasize to the adrenals and brain. And the neuroblastoma, it metastasizes to liver and bones. So this can be explained by the tropism of particular kinds of tumor cells for specific tissues. The tumor cells may express adhesion molecules. The tumor cells express adhesion molecules whose ligands are preferentially found on the endothelial cells of the target organ. The solid tumor cells often express CD44. Which enhance their spread to lymph nodes and other metastatic sites. Now some tumor cells, they may fail to grow at distant site, whereas others grow very well at particular tumor site. This can be explained on the basis of seed soil hypothesis. It was given by Paget. According to it, the ability of a tumor cell to adapt to a foreign microenvironment is limited to certain tissues. Some tissues provide a favorable soil for the growth of the tumor seedlings, whereas others do not provide. For example, the skeletal muscles, spleen, despite having a rich vascular supply, metastases are rare here because they provide unfavorable soil for the growth of the tumor seedlings. Now, some breast carcinoma which metastasize to bone, they secrete parathormone related protein, and this stimulates osteoblasts to form rank ligand, and this rank ligand then activates the osteoclasts which degrade the bone matrix and thus release the growth factors, insulin like growth factors and transforming growth factor beta, and these factors then act on the tumor cells. They act on the receptors present on the tumor cells, and this leads to the growth and survival of the tumor cells. This enhances the growth and survival of the tumor cells. So in today's video, we studied about angiogenesis, invasion and metastasis. I hope this was useful. For more such videos, please subscribe my channel and do not forget to like and share my videos. Thanks for watching.